process, passed a law, AB 32. States are much more nimble, and they can copy and join. So AB 32 said California will get to Kyoto and remain under the criteria for 2-degree temp rise. And, you know, doing this in the 7th largest economy on the planet, showing how it can be done, showing the mix of strategies that it will take, and how they feather together and self-reinforce, is an incredibly important act, and it's now happened. And everybody needs to be much more aware of this, and there needs to be concerted efforts in every state to take these strategies aboard. California, the implementation rests on 4 things. One is converting the power grid to green, which they have now a whole strategy that's going to be set back, by the way, by closing our nuclear power plant. So we're going to go deficit for a while, and then we have to dig our way out. So the strategy of how much, how many of those electrons, which, by the way, run electric cars, everybody seems to forget that electric cars aren't clean unless the grid is clean. This is an absurd notion. So that's one thing, is converting the utilities. The second is cap and trade, which gets at, as I mentioned, industrial process as well as other major point sources of carbon emissions. This is a great strategy because it throws off money that we're now using to invest in transit, high-speed rail, and other, and bikeways, and all sorts of good things that we need. So it's a win-win in terms of carbon and in terms of livability. The third one is building retrofits, and of course, new energy standards. Back when Jerry was first governor in the 70s, which is where I actually started working for the guy, we passed House 24, one of the most progressive building conservation strategies. And so most of the new buildings in California, which is a mild climate, operate well, and actually building energy is pretty low. But it is more, it's still a big number. And the problem, of course, is all the buildings that were built prior to the 70s, which are leaking. How do you get them converted? Theoretically, technically easy. In terms of money and policy, very difficult. We've been developing tools for that. And then the fourth one, the one we love, is SB 375, which is state legislation that says that land use will contribute to the reduction in carbon emissions in the state, and we will have a region-by-region sustainable community strategy developed, which reduces auto dependence and carbon emissions from mobile sources, and empowers the regions to actually think strategically over the long term about land use and transportation investments. That law needed a tool to measure outcomes so that they could actually keep track of how well, who was complying, who wasn't. And also needed a tool to figure out what were reasonable targets over what periods of time. I'm going to get a little nerdy in this kind of conversation, but you know, I think we're all past the slogans. You know, we've got to get down to the numbers that matter and will make a difference politically. So they asked us to take the tool that we were playing with in-house and turn it into a tool for this implementation of this law. Now, the law was all about carbon, but of course, we snuck in all the co-benefits, what I call, the social and economic and other environmental benefits. And in the end, that's what made the sustainable community strategy successful in the state of California. You can pass a law, but if you have local opposition, we all know that it doesn't go very far. And so by being able to demonstrate at many levels this question of all the co-benefits, we succeeded where we had failed in the past. Okay, so Vision California was the first take to show everybody in the state what happens if you really implement SB 375. Next slide. And we did a whole series of these metrics. Now, these are just some of the metrics embedded now in Footprint. But they're very, very significant. The quantity of land, this is that now speaks to all the environmentalists and agricultural interests in the state of California, land consumption. Big. And I'm going to try to go through these pretty quickly. So next. Not that many. So this is what LA looks like under a compact future. Next year. Oops, sorry. That was sprawl. This is compact. Go back and forth. Pretty amazing difference. Mm-hmm. These kind of visceral images actually really do have a big impact politically. Next slide. Of course, for us, for many people, BMT, this is the part of the wall of reducing BMT per capita. And so 10,000 miles less per capita for a compact transit-oriented future versus a business-as-usual future. This gave everybody a sense of how big and important the land use component of those four elements of implementing 8032 really is. Next. This, of course, we've all seen graphs like this, but for many people who haven't been engaged in these issues, just showing what kind of BMT happens really is very powerful. And the variation here is from over 30,000 per household down to around 7,000 per household. So people are just not aware that location and lifestyle makes a huge difference in travel behavior. We will posit that, but now everybody can document it. Next. I didn't put the bar graph in here, but there are two health impacts, air quality having to do with asthma-related health issues, and activity having to do with cardiovascular. We have the first one up and running, the air quality, and this second one, activity-based, will be up by January. So we can actually document health impacts, and of course it varies by neighborhood, especially air quality impacts. Low-income communities, for example, tend to live closer to freeways and noxious environment, air quality environments, although they are also ubiquitous phenomena. Central Valley and the lower-income populations there suffer extreme cases of asthma. And then putting a number on that in terms of health care is an important step in communicating the case. And of course, this is health indicators. It's really just a picture of walkability in the region of Southern California. And once again, the variation is built around urban form. Next slide. Household costs, of course, is the biggest driver in terms of social equity issues, but also in terms of voters. This is a huge outcome for the state of California. If you can reduce the average income reduce the average cost by $10,000 in a state where the median income is around $52,000, this is a huge lifestyle difference. And when I think the Center for Neighborhood Technology has made a really powerful case here, which is when you really think about what happened in 2008 and the collapse of the mortgage industry, it was really about selling too much of the wrong kind of housing in the wrong place to people who couldn't afford it. If you build too much, if you have too much bad inventory, the only thing you can do is discount it. That's how you move it off the shelf. So that's what they did. They discounted the mortgages for a time period and suckered people into buying something that they really didn't want or couldn't afford. Next. The whole revenue city fiscal balance sheet is another one that we've always focused on, which is, boy, it's more expensive to sprawl for City Hall than it is to be able to compact. And once again, a lot of hand waving, but not real numbers. But now we can get real numbers. Obviously, this is just a part of the revenue. Then there's infrastructure costs, operations and maintenance. These are all numbers we get out of footprint at this point. Next. That's in there twice. Next. Or you maybe went back. So then we get back to the place we started, which is why we're doing this for the state of California, is to reduce carbon. You'll notice that buildings, business as usual, buildings and passenger vehicles are about equal, but undergrowing smart. Actually, that's reversed, unfortunately. Next slide, I'll get into that in greater detail. So here's what we ended up doing for them. Just punch through this. Okay, so that's 1990. The business as usual with adopted policy, which is a very aggressive adopted policy. Smart growth, big reduction. Vehicle efficiency, big reduction in the travel side. Low carbon fuels, another big, and you know, under that comes electric vehicles based on green electrons. Building efficiency reduces, but doesn't, you see, doesn't take a big enough bite out of the building side of carbon emissions. Renewable power, the grid gets better, buildings get somewhat better. The goal is that. So you can see on the transportation side, California can get there, and our biggest challenge is still those old, leaky buildings. Next slide. So how does this play out? LA, we did a regional plan for LA in 2003, and it was ignored. And then we did it again with the SCS law, which of course helped, but also with the multiple factors. So we were able to show fiscal impacts to cities. That was the key. You never know which issue creates the tipping point for political consensus, but you do know that all these metrics gather together special interest groups in kind of ecologies that hadn't been present. It's hard to bust people out of their special interests, but when they start to see that their interests align with other people, they naturally build coalitions, and coalitions are what move the needle politically. Next. So, you know, this is the kind of output. We always do these grids where you have the scenarios on the top, the scenarios on the side and the impacts on top. Next slide. And, you know, this is, it looks intense. We use these in workshops and they have a big impact. Actually, people who are willing to show up to a workshop are actually willing to think and read, which is a lot more you can say for anything. Next slide. And so the answer in LA is simple. You go from this, next, to this, to this. Next slide. Yeah, so, you know, everybody recognized, and we could do a very simple analysis using Aaron's footprint to identify all the parcels that sit on commercial strips that have low FAR. So we could actually document exactly where they were, how many they were, and what would happen if you converted them all from an FAR of 0.3 to mixed use at, you know, 1.5 or 2. Any number you choose. Next slide. So we've had success elsewhere using the methodology. Next. And in Utah, of course, as a red state, it's not sympathetic, as I've always said. And all these numbers kind of matter. Next slide. But the biggest one was the infrastructure cost. This is what got the state legislature interested, because they were true conservatives. They actually cared about wasting tax dollars, which actually isn't a bad attribute after all. So they ended up with a $15 billion savings between the scenarios that we presented. Next. And then adopted the statewide legislation for quality growth. So I want to zoom in a little bit. So this is all, we kind of started at this regional scale, and you can do this broad, but most practitioners don't get to do regional planning. And as important as it is, most practitioners are working for a city on a corridor plan or a general plan update or a neighborhood plan, or they're working for a developer on a project site. And so the key is how can we make this the same capacity that we brought to bear in these regional circumstances available to everyday practitioners, everyday city planning departments. And one example, and this is a citywide, of course, but it's a very specific one, which was Honolulu, perfect for transit, high density linear city, one line will do the whole job. It's really made to order. Actually had funding from the feds, $5 billion transit system, and the environmentalists came out against it and actually ran a candidate for city Paul, who was going to undo it and basically stop the thing, even though they had $2 billion of the $5 billion on the plate already. Next. So, you know, footprint quickly allows you to go through and actually figure out where the development opportunities are, and then create a scenario that says, well, what if we were to do real TODs along these lines? Next. And then, so we did this, and we have all these numbers. The most important number here was very interesting, which is this is highway and arterial costs. If you do nothing, you basically have to double deck the existing freeway because there's no space in Honolulu for another ring road. They just basically have to go double deck. That's $10 billion. And of course, rail is $5 billion. So all of a sudden, everybody was saying, well, we can't afford a rail system. We realized that actually they could afford it, and that actually was a bargain in all these other things. So once again, this mind-boggling array of numbers, each person finds their own set of numbers that are important. Next slide. So here's urban footprint. We did the work for the state. I realized that this needs to be a tool that anybody can use. You don't even need a GIS capacity in your office. Any planner or urban designer should be able to sit down and work this thing. So the three things we had to do was make it easy for everybody to use, not my in-house guys. The second was to make the database ubiquitous across all of the United States, not just California. And the third was, how do we make it work at the project scale, like a small scale, so we can get that relevance. And we've done that. I can't tell you how frustrating, time-consuming, and expensive it's been. I had no idea. I have promised to so many people so many times that, yes, it's here, yes, it's here. And of course, it's never there. But anyway, it's going to be here in January. And we have betas out being used by, I think, some of the leading firms from CMU. And I'll drill down. I don't know how much more time I have. Who's timing it?
You've got, I think, another 15, 20 minutes.
Oh, okay.
We gave you 40.
No problem. Okay. Next slide. So this is what I was talking about, is that we go from scale to scale to scale. And quite frankly, if you're doing a project, sometimes it helps to back up and actually look at the whole region. So for example, if you want to compare the VMT generated per household in your project to the regional norm and make the case that this is an improvement, or to the city norm, that's useful to you. So even if you're working at a small scale, you also need to be able to look at the large scale. And many of us believe that to do good design, you have to start thinking at the regional scale, see the watershed, see the patterns of employment and housing and the relationships, understand the regional transportation network and some of the regional challenges, you know, such as where population concentrations of low income are and things like that. So being able to slip between scales, I think, is a really powerful dimension of all this. Next slide. It's built in these four steps. One is explore data, and each one is kind of a big deal unto itself. It's why building this software has been such a heavy lift. First is data. Now, everybody says big data is here, there's tons of data, and on one level, it's true, it's like trying to drink out of a fire hydrant. On another level, there's a lot of critical data that just isn't available. You know, parcel data is available sometimes locally, if you can twist the arm of your local jurisdiction. Getting parcel data for the whole country has been one of our big hurdles. And then, because it's such a big database, being able to digest it and use it in a way that doesn't get that little wheel spinning on the computer for a couple hours, that all huge. But the idea is that when you get footprint, you can open it up and go anywhere and have parcel data, parcel level information. And embedded in those parcel data is a huge amount of information. So you know, and I'll show you some of the things you get there. And then, of course, there's just ginormous types of data. I can't even begin to list what we've got loaded here. But the beauty is it's going to keep growing. We're going to keep adding additional database as it comes out. And the range of things you can investigate is really extraordinary. And you can layer in what's called buffer. So you can say, here's a transit line. Show me all the land within a quarter mile of it, and let's now explore the attributes of all that land. So you can do, you can actually simply do, measures of walking and transit accessibility and all that. That's just in the data side. Now, if you're going to build scenarios, we all believe in place time. of a controversy within the CMU, because form-based codes say, well, we don't care that much about the actual use, we just care about the form of the buildings, and over time, the use may change. Well, that's really Pollyannish, I have to say, because when you want to do some serious analysis about how much affordable housing there is, what density of employment is there, and how accessible it is, you have to have use as well as form. Both of them matter. And so place types, the way we've constructed them, are both. You have the urban form, the density, the walkability, the density of the street grid, the degree of sidewalk-fronting buildings, and all the rest of that, all the good form stuff. But you also have this huge range of different densities and different kinds of mixes. And if you're doing serious planning, you need that. I mean, you can't do a general plan update just saying, well, we're just going to have these forms. We don't care whether these are all businesses or not. For example, Silicon Valley, every city puts up their hand and says, yes, please, to another major office and tech company, and no thank you to housing. So please don't tell me that land use doesn't matter. I mean, it does. You could have beautiful buildings that would accommodate either housing or anyway, I'm going on too long. You get my drift, people. So building scenarios, we have two levels. We have building types, so that you can go in and precisely label individual parcels for your project, and place types, which are larger, broader, and they involve a mix and also a whole set of urban form issues. Then the analytics. So here we go through this huge list now of everything that we all talk about and think about in terms of impacts. And then, of course, building consensus. We can do this on the fly. You can go through a charrette and build a scenario, and by the end of the charrette, actually give people the results. When we started, it took us 2 years to do that, and a ton of consultants who cost a shitload of money. I mean, and now you just get to do it yourself. Next. These are just repeating all that. Next, I'll just get through this and get into it. As you're building scenarios, you actually can keep track of the changes and the sum total of the physical design change that you're doing. Next. And then here we are. Those are the first screen there is the kind of the first level of analytical tools. The beauty is we're constantly adding more analytics. And we have the capacity, once you build a scenario, to plug in some third-party analytics, like the National Flood and Stormwater Model, which is an incredibly sophisticated piece of work. But one of the inputs it needs is, well, what environment do you want us to analyze? Well, it's kind of set up to analyze the existing environment. What if you could analyze your hypothetical future? And so we just plug that in to the software and expand. I already mentioned activity-related, rural lands and conservation. I'll talk about that in a minute. And all these extra modules are just examples of how the thing grows. So it grows in database, it grows in place types. I forgot to mention with place types, we offer, I think, about 37 of them right now. Any user will be able to go in and create their own special place type. If they say, well, this doesn't fit what I want to do or the nature of this place, you create a place type that fits it and articulates it. Next slide. I'm going to get into a bunch of these user interface maps in a minute. So this just gives you the whole thing, an overview of what you get. And so, I don't know, is there a pointer around? Over here on this column, you can explore, which is you just get the database and map it. Build, which is when you actually put place types into it. Analysis is, okay, I built a scenario, let's analyze it according to a bunch of things. And printout is just the presentation end of the software. You get, oh, there we go, just got that. Thank you. I need this. This is a precision operation, guys. This is not slogan hearing now. So this column actually lets you select the different layers. This gives you a parcel by parcel summary of the data that is associated with this. I mean, this is frighteningly detailed. So you can go in and get all sorts of different information on a parcel by parcel basis. This then gives you, what is this? This is ozone, and this is CS3 score. I have no idea what that is. Next slide. But so this is Madison, and this is one of those buffering exercises where you say, here's the transit line, here's the walk radius, and here's all the land use within that. You can then select different land uses in these corridors and then command to substitute a different building type or place type in that, and instantly you have a new scenario. So as I mentioned before, next. Okay, this one's really good. I have no idea what this is all about. All I know is that it takes all this to generate what we call the base canvas. So the base canvas is a translation of all the existing conditions and the existing zoning into place types. So you can begin to think of it. Every city has its own unique zoning. And then, of course, from census data, we have the reality as per the last census, which is population and building type, building footprint, all. I mean, household income, household expenditure. I mean, just, there's a giant database, and it's related to place in the census tract. So we take that data and the local zoning, and we translate it into our language, which then allows, and we can do this across whole regions. So rather than a patchwork of different zoning codes that really don't coordinate with one another as you want to think at a regional scale, it translates everything into one place type, not language, place type language. And so that's a fundamental act that's very complicated. So this is Madison with place types overlaid. You can just get in here. The grain is about parcel size. And then, of course, colors are about use and the universe. Next. And then you, I think I've got into this already. So you choose whether you want to use place types or building types, and then you get a menu of these things, which is frightening, and then you begin to place it. But after you use it for a while, you get to know which one place types you like. And, you know if you want to get a three FAR office building on this parcel or mixed use building, you can do that. Next. You can basically, you always start with the existing conditions, and then you can clone that and transform it into your scenario. Next. And then this is really one of the key elements. Working at the city scale, working at the project scale, you can take a little neighborhood corner and ask, well, what happens if we change that neighborhood in this way? Now, it's not going to move the needle very much for the outcomes for the whole city. But what you can do is you can measure all the impacts and behaviors of this project and compare it to the norm of the city, which is the most useful to me. Are we doing better or worse? By the way, we just passed a new law in the state of California talking about this compared to the norm. We all struggle with LOS, level of service. That's like what every neighborhood group uses to stop our infill projects. Because, of course, an infill project is going to generate traffic on local streets, and that's going to impact the level of service, and everybody freaks out. And that was part of the environmental documentation that was required by the state. We just changed that from LOS to VMT. It's a really profound shift. So when you do, when you file environmental impact reports in California now, you don't actually even calculate LOS. You calculate VMT and you compare it to the regional norm. If your project is better than the regional norm, which most infill inherently is, you get a big plus in your environmental impact report. And you can go out and talk about it. and they will, of course, sue you about it, but that's another story. But the issue here is that we flip from having a metric that destroys infill political viability to a metric that actually enhances it. And once again, to implement that law, you need a tool like this to make those calculations. You know, as you're painting, creating your scenario, getting all the development constraints, environmental and whatnot, on the map in front of you, clear in your head, and quite frankly, clear to whatever stakeholder group you're working with is important. Thanks. So this is just a beginning list of, we're at 35 place types here, and then over 100 building types that you can use. The place types are multi-block, so they get into walkability and mix at a neighborhood or district scale. These are some of the factors that impact place type. How many, we all know about the 8 D's.
Yes.
Yeah? Anybody else want to explain it? I can never remember all 8 of them. But anyway, the things that drive travel behavior, some of our friends in the traffic world have finally realized that it has to do with more than freeway size, and it has to do with density, diversity. Come on, please help me, somebody.
Design.
What?
Distance.
What?
Design, density, diversity, destination, distance to travel, distance to transit, and then P. So it's 5 D's and P, with P being parking.
Okay. The grandpa here can't remember these things. But the bottom line is place types has a measurement for each of the D's, and therefore allows a much more progressive traffic analysis. So let me go to that for a minute. The cities run really big gravity models. We all know about that. And that's origin, destination, links, and a whole range of factors that, you know, more often than not have been way off in their calibration. Footprint works on a different basis. It's an empirical basis that says if you have this kind of environment in this regional location, you'll have these types of travel behaviors. So it's empirical, not simulation based. We have to make it, if you backcast it, it has to comply both with reality and with the gravity models, and more often than not, but it's much more progressive. So it understands the impact of urban design in a much finer grained manner than the gravity models that are out there. And so a lot of times we will get different results than the big city or regional gravity model. And there's a lot of arm wrestling around that. The fact that the state of California recognizes this tool and its analytical methodology is a very important step to maintain the credibility of saying, well, okay, this is not the same as the gravity model, but it is recognized. Next. So you get a drop down. So when you get in the interface, you get a drop down of the place types, and you click on them and you paint them. Next. So this is maybe, and then there are summaries of every place type, so you can get once again, I want this to be used by NGOs, neighborhood groups, planners that really don't even believe in CNU or urbanism. A whole range of people that would be befuddled by the idea of a place type. And so we try to get really clear explanation of what the place types are. Next. And as you're applying place types, so let's say these three parcels are selected and you're changing the use, you instantly get a summary of what's going on in the domain you've chosen. Next slide. So this is tracking progress. So we're working right now. If you had a large parcel and you were doing a project and you had a plan for a different street network and land use disposition, you will be able to import that into the base canvas and then paint it. So that's an important step that we're still but they're just meant to impress you with how clever and complicated it all is. But the truth is, you don't need to really have this. This is just how the process goes through to the different analytical engines, which are in dark here, off the scenario, and then how they feed into outputs. Next slide. So this is, this is water. So this is a scenario in Madison, and this is just a feed out on water consumption by parcel. Something of use if you care about that. But the point is, you can care about any number of things. Next slide. This is GMT per household by location and parcel. Pretty classic diagram. Next slide. And then the range of metrics I'll get into in a little bit, but basically it gives you the ubiquitous bar graphs, terrible, not so terrible, okay, great, is the way, and then the scenarios, those are the names I like to use now, next. And of course, you can then produce these kind of things, which, believe it or not, are useful, next. Okay, so as Steve Jobs would say, and one more thing. Because in California, building energy was kind of one of the big final milestones to get through, they asked us to develop a much more detailed, sophisticated analytical tool around building renovation and upgrades. And so we did that, and that will be in the California Building Energy Explorer, will be part of the analytical tools that everybody will have next, if you want to drill down that far. So it allows you to look really in great detail at what buildings are on the ground, the types, the energy use, the emissions and costs, whole range of information. You have to understand where you're starting from. Next. And then it lets you, in the same fashion as with everything else in the footprint, paint in different alternatives. And they can be policies. So at the same time that you have this map-based thing where you're changing urban form, you can also turn a dial on policy. So you could, for example, you could change the percent of green energy in the grid. Now that's going to change the carbon emissions that we will attribute to buildings, and it will also have an impact on the utility costs in a building. And so you have these toggles in addition to land use that you can actually use to simulate different policy options. And at the state level, different policy options are really next. The next one that I love is the Nature Conservancy, the biggest environmental group on the planet, came to us and said, this is really cool, but you're only dealing with the urban environment. What about the rest of the environment? What about ag, ecology, open space, all that? We want you to develop place maps. We want to be able to do the same thing you're doing with the urban environment with the natural environment. In other words, you can paint it with different agricultural types, agricultural processes. You can preserve in certain, you can put conservation easements that mean certain things rather than others. Yeah, you can basically manipulate the undeveloped lands in the same way that you're, and then you can measure the outcomes. Next slide. So, next slide. So, these are some of the analytical outcomes of this particular, and this is another module that plugs into the footprint. Carbon impacts, water recharge, habitat connectivity, agricultural resource, and economic impact. That sounds too good to be true. I don't know what it's real. Next. And then, as I mentioned, we are working, and this is not trivial, the relationship between active transportation, i.e. walking and biking. I don't know why you have to call them. And of course, correlating mental health. Big issue. Next. So all these things are on the way. Equity and accessibility modeling is already in place now. So you can model anywhere exactly what accessibility for what income, what segment of the population is available. Next slide. putting the EPA stormwater model into, on the top of footprint is something that we're going to be having done, I think, relatively soon. Next slide. So that's that. I could stop here, or let me just run through very quickly some screenshots of the user interface. Next, just so that we. So as I was saying, this is a bit clear. So you have your scenarios up here. You have your location. This is the user. You have explore, build, analyze, and report. Now, right now, I've got explore on. So these are some of the layers you can see. And if you click on the base parcel canvas, this gives you the translation of everything into a place type. Next slide. But you could, for example, look at walking distance to the nearest school. You can get an overall map of that. Next slide. Or to restaurants. This is census data. Can't quite see the dip variation, but it's household income by area. Next slide. This one is, and this is just a random sampling. This is smart location. So this has to do with intersection density in the landscape. Next slide. And then for all these maps, you can get data on every single parcel. Next slide. Then, what is this one? This one is just wetlands, environmental factors. So you can turn on different layers, and then you can add them on top of each other. Next slide. So you can build the kind of map. You can communicate the information you want to communicate. You can get the information you want really easily. Then you can communicate it. So here's the base canvas. If we go to build, next slide. You get to choose from these drop downs, which are all the place types. Next slide. And then as you apply them, you get a summary of what's going on, and how you're impacting total unit count, and things like that. Next. And then when you go to analytics, you have all these analytical tools up here that also that you can punch on. Some of them, like transportation, take, I don't know, a couple of minutes to run. So it's not like instant. Don't be disappointed, please. Zero. And then, next slide. And then, of course, you can get data on each place next. That's the end. Because
talked And you mentioned that footprint enables kind of a more multi-dimensional public engagement. And I didn't see you talk about it today, but I thought that was an important piece of footprint.
Yeah. You know, a lot of people want to be able to take iPads and, you know, put them on desks and have people build scenarios. That may be possible. I'm not as sanguine about that as doing a charrette where people identify the things that they want to see in their preferred scenario. And then whoever's facilitating builds a scenario and gets the results and, you know, the next day gives them the feedback. And I think that's probably a better way of doing it. Because, you know, even though we've designed this so that any design or planning professional can use it, and somebody on an NGO staff like NRDC could, you know, spend a little time to be able to do it. Actually putting it in the hands of citizens at a table, I'm not convinced. You know, you spend more time explaining stuff than you would actually being covered. So I see it in the kind of 1 and 2 day feedback loop rather than the instant feedback loop. But yeah, it's really meant. I mean, the whole hypothesis here is to reach consensus, you have to build scenarios. You have to show everybody what they think the best future is and what the results of that are. And there's an aha moment. People really don't, you know, I always tell the story about in Salt Lake City, where we just gave people a map of the region and we gave them a stack of chips representing the next 1 million people at current densities. And we said, okay, sit at a table of six. We made sure that people were mixed up. They weren't in little social groups. And we said, show us where the next 1 million people go. Nobody could solve the problem without stacking the chips and putting the chips over existing developed areas. So all of a sudden, they learned why density and infill make sense. You could talk to them all day and all night about why it makes sense, and they wouldn't believe you. But you give them the exercise and they do it. So then, when they do these kinds of exercises, which are more simplistic, you then can go off and build a scenario and say, okay, you know, six of the tables thought this was the right way to go, and here are the results. And 20 of the tables did this, and you can do it that way. So that's more the way I see it happening. And quite frankly, it doesn't have to be planners or city officials. It can be, as I've said, it can be environmental groups or NGOs of any type to go out and build scenarios and hold workshops.
Question. There's a lot of great stuff that was impossible to absorb just by watching. Any chance you might consider posting the presentation?
Actually, there's a website. I'm supposed to tell you about the website. It's urbanfootprint.io, not com. We did not get domain.
But can't we also
and
post?
So you can go there, and you know it'll give you the most broad sales pitch. But you can also sign up for a demo and get somebody from our office. We're now at this scale where we're just kind of doing a lot of hand-holding with people who are interested. My attitude is CNU should be the vanguard in using this, and so call up and get a demo.
We also live stream Peter's presentation on CNU's YouTube channel, and we'll send that link around. And if Peter says it's all right, we'll take this presentation, turn it into a PDF, and post it with the rest.
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, I screwed up. I should have left you with the website. And the bad news is, because we're young, if you search for Urban Footprint, you actually won't find the right. I mean, there are lots of things that come up under Urban Footprint other than IO. So we got that problem solved. Yeah.
It was really impressive. One thing about the VMT maps you showed, actually, Jennifer showed some of them as well. Those may be a bit misleading if you read them and jump into the conclusion that, oh, urban centers are really great. See, one example she gave was Boulder compared to other cities. Boulder, Colorado is really great in terms of transportation. Yeah. It's about 100,000 population more, there's 60,000 moves in and moves out daily. So that means any given time, 60% of the people you see on the street already travel there. And that map is not capturing that because it goes to the hospital. I don't know.
Let me just interrupt you.
Yeah.
And that's why being able to zoom out to the regional scale is very important. I mean, there's a huge actually measure ecosystem benefits and agricultural carbon sequestration value and economic value of ag. And, you know, all the stuff we did because PNC said, you know, let's not leave all that out of the equation when you're building a scenario. The tools are there. It's just a matter of who wants to implement them and in what way in the specific. The other thing that's great about this is that we tend to get these national studies that, you know, calibrate things. Each place is unique. The thing about footprint is it lets you get into the uniqueness of each place and make the interventions that are appropriate for that place.
Steve, this is an incredible tool. I want to congratulate you for putting that together. I can't wait till it's available for everybody. I'm thinking of...
By the way, it's going to cost money. It turns out that building this thing was not free. I thought.
How much?
We're not saying that. We're working on it. Can you use that
to actually look at the California high-speed rail system and when it's built per phase, what it will do in terms of carbon reduction, and also maybe the LA Metro system that's wildly expanding right now, and actually run those numbers and show the resulting carbon?
Actually, that's what Vision California was. The reality of high-speed rail is that it's not just a local impact at a station. It just lights up all the regional transportation networks. So if you arrive by high-speed rail in Southern California, I think there are 12 stations throughout the LA area, Southern California area. And what it is it becomes part of the regional transportation network. And so a scenario that looks at a pod future for the state of California is exactly what you're talking about. Now, would there be a lesser Todd version of the future without high-speed rail? Yes. We did not calculate offsets against air travel.
Can you actually calculate how much carbon is reduced by a specific rail system?
No, by a specific land use pattern. Okay. So in other words, you have to build a scenario around the transit system and its proximity to transit impacts the VMT and the quantity of population and jobs near the transit obviously impacts. When you compare it to a baseline scenario where there's no transit and no urban form focus.
Does the rural version of this that you're working on, does it deal directly with agriculture and the distinctions between industrial and...
Conservation module, it's called, deals with different agricultural practices. I think mainly at this point around water and carbon sequestration strategies.
Yeah, it's just a great tool. Fantastic. Just on the housing affordability front, I've got a bigger question, which is SB 375, how it addresses housing affordability, but specifically in the tool, picking up on the earlier presentation about transportation,
know, it will be free to universities. So any university research center who wants to use this to develop strategies like that and develop analytical tools gets to use it for your education. That's a good price, right?
The land use data that you have in there, is that supposed to be provided by the agency that's using it, or do you have you collected all that type of information?
We have spent first of all, there's a lot of public domain data, you know, starting with census tract, also environmental data and all that. Parcel data we are purchasing. It's a big buy, so it means that, you know, the average practitioner wouldn't be able to get parcel data because it's too expensive. Us, and that's really valuable. Now, this parcel data is national parcel data. It's not going to be as clean or as up-to-date as what a city can have. So you still have the capacity to download the city data and use it instead. But there's a starting point.
Well, first of all, it's extraordinary, and kudos to you, especially as a Californian, that is just amazing. What I particularly like is how it could turn the whole EIR process in the state of California on its head, because there's so many poor assumptions within that EIR process. I have two questions. The first one is, in respect to that, the data for multifamily housing and trying to assess energy consumption and things like that, how did you get that? So there's parcel data, are you going in like to people's, I guess I'm thinking about my own. Are you looking at my utility bills or, you know, what data exists?
Yeah, I mean, I hate to scare you, but yeah, that's available.
Okay. All right. And and then the other, this was a comment, sort of, I understand the idea that you want some bad scenarios and some good scenarios. You can find out what a good scenario is. I'm trying to figure out how the trying to tease out the new urbanist bias within this, if I presume there's some very bad sprawl, you know, like malls that continue to have a lot of peripheral parking and things like that are single use and separated and whatnot, that you could use it as a place type. But could you describe the place types a little bit more in more detail so we could get a feel for what that scenario planning would look like?
Actually, we have a, Andreas will like this. You know, part of the definition of a place type is its transect type. And so you can quickly look, and so you can say, well, here's the bundle of all the crap. What transect number is that?
SD.
Yeah, whatever.
Special districts.
Yeah.
Which means that they're specialized uses.
It's no, but you have the suburban, you know,
suburban. Yeah.
What's that? That's number four or something?
No, the suburban is built into the system at every level. It's a triage system.
It anyway, exists. We've tried to put in each place type one of those categories. But the long and short is you have a full matrix of standard development opportunities. All the standard, I remember Chris Leinberg saying, well, you know, there are these packages that get financed in these ways. Each one of those packages it can be a place type. So the place types aren't all the good stuff. And the single-use zones are not the alternative under it.
Peter, one of the things that caused problems was when you use the yellow, orange, red range in your mapping, even if you're talking about dense things and walkable things, it actually recalls to people suburban types.
Yeah.
And what happens is, since suburban types continue to exist, we actually dug up the old system from the 1910. There is actually on a purple range, and so now we map. I mean, for years we've been mapping the red, orange. They're all place types, but the red, orange, the yellow, red, orange, red are the suburban walkable ones, and the purple tinged ones because they continue to exist on the map. And what we have found with your mapping is that the good stuff and the bad stuff is actually this red. Because red is always thought of as just dense. And by the way, a shopping mall might be red.
Yeah.
And so we've actually made that distinction right.
You know, I can't believe my engineers did it, but they actually allow you to pick whatever color scheme you want.
Oh.
Now, I consider that a adjust the opacity.
Right.
You can adjust line weight. You can fine tune your mapping so that it communicates. And I'm 100% with you. You know, data is only useful as a communication tool. If you're not getting the message across with your map or your numbers, you're not succeeding in communication. In the end, it's all about communication. So they did that. They've done a lot of stuff, I thought was a waste of time. That's why it's taken us 5 years.
So, Peter, a comment and a serious question. I can see how much fun this could be if kids got a hold of it and started figuring out the worst possible scenarios, competing with each other, you know, to generate which way to help educate them. But I can see this becoming a sort of toy or something like that.
Well, you know, our original tagline was going to be Sin City for real. Sin City wouldn't let us do it.
So, the question is
they thought we'd take the fun out of it.
Although, people will find a way to have some fun in it.
Yeah.
Especially with colors. Can you imagine? The question is actually not about the program, but about California High Speed Rail. Every time I bring it up, I hear, oh, it's the train to nowhere. It was on the national news this morning as the train to nowhere. Can you tell us how to deal with those?
Do you remember the bridge to nowhere? It's a standard Republican trope.
Well, how do we
discredit any infrastructure investment by saying it's not going to work?
How do we rebut it? Why are they saying that? I mean,
first of all, there are people that you really don't want to spend energy trying to convince. If they're intentionally stupid, then you're not going to fix that. But I will say this about, and it was a very complicated trade-off. The federal government said when we start building the high-speed rail, you've got to do it in the Central Valley because a big part of the high-speed rail is connecting the low-income part of California to the high-income, the Central Valley to the coast. And it should service the Central Valley first. What they didn't want was the wealthy San Francisco, LA basin to get high-speed rail, which, as I mentioned, functions pretty nicely as a standalone enhancement to the regional transit system. And then never get to the low-income population in the Central Valley. So they mandated that the trains start there. Now, you can't build a train line like this all at once, unless you're China. And so it has to go in phases. So the first phase is in the Central Valley, and people look at it and say, well, that just goes from Fresno to Palmdale. You know? What the hell is that about? But they're just being intentionally stupid. I don't know any other way of saying it. And yes, if you do not complete it, it will be a train to nowhere. They are right, you know, so there's a tautology to their argument, which is if they succeed, they will be correct.
Will you be able to use predictive analytics as transportation technology advances, so for rideshare, center rides, or the fleet mix of autonomous?
Yeah, that's a really good question. The answer is yes, but that's, once again, a further enhancement to analytical modules.
Right.
And that would be a policy knob,
yes.
Not a land use knob. So it would basically say average occupancy is now X instead of Y.
Yeah.
Two questions.
I'll talk to you personally.
This looks great. I was going to ask about, are any of your place types normative for urbanism? That is to say, based on pet sheds and so forth. You partially answered it by saying you have a neutral, it's a neutral tool. But then when you said that the place types were set within transect zones, I want to make sure that this whole range of tools that already exist, that we're not like flipping the grid from those tools to your tool by using the transect in a different way. So
well, it kind of takes a, you know, where the transect is one, the place types will be maybe 15 different place types within that transect.
Yeah, you run into a problem when you get to the urban transect zones 3, 4, 5, and 6, that they are actually used in all of our tools within pet sheds, within community types of place types, not the other way around. So they're really at the fine grain.
Yeah.
So I just want to make sure. I mean, I want to look at it really
quickly. No, the place types, I think the main differentiation is being very precise about use. more precise with painting. So you take a certain area and you say, well, this much of it is actually walkable and this much of it isn't. And you can do that down to the parcel level.
The first time that you came up with place types, which was actually so long ago that Shelley was still working before she became head of the CNU, et cetera, that's how long ago it was. It was an immediately came up with a translation tool between the two.
Yeah.
And now we need to see what new place types are and refurbish this.
Yeah, that's a